Okay. Jody Garner would call Kathy Echols and when she comes over.
That'd be fine. Thank you very much.
No problem.
Morning, how you doing?
Good, great, thank you.
Hey, how are you?
Good.
She was wanting to attend the meeting, so will someone come up?
Oh, yeah, sure. We'll send Kathy up, you bet.
Okay, all right.
Good morning, Mr. Carl.
How are you?
Doing well, thank you.
Carl, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good. Nice family.
Pretty good, pretty good.
Can we go on in or?
I've seen two go back. There's no meeting ahead of you, so it should be unlocked.
Are you going in our meeting?
When I'm allowed to enter, yes.
You're?
I'm waiting for that.
What?
Yes, I started. Thank you.
Morning, Mr. Carl.
Morning.
I'm meeting up here today.
Okay, thanks.
Hi, Nydia.
Morning, Kathy.
Hi, Ms. Carla.
Morning.
Good morning.
That's fine.
Kathy, may I come back now or do I need to?
I have no business.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Our super camera woman.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Good morning, how you doing there? Appreciate you posting that notice online. I was able to make my way to it.
Good.
Oh, can we go on back?
Kathy, we'll get set up.
Are they back in the forum right now?
They've got Mr. Van Sant, Mr. Perry, who else has entered?
Can I come on back?
Yeah, I'll come on back.
Lordy, they're in a pre-meeting back there.
There are. Yeah.
You heard that and overnight.
The pre-meeting meeting.
Right, the council in advance. That's what I was observing too.
Okay, thank you.
I don't understand why I can't get into these meetings when everybody else is in them.
Maybe it did trip, right?
Nydia, did you want to go back over here where you usually stand during the?
Yes, ma'am, I certainly will.
This is an opportunity to.
You know, they always say during the door. Here's your agenda.
Thank you very much.
How long have I been back here? I couldn't get in.
I just walked back here a couple minutes ago.
Y'all are back here.
Well, sorry.
Oh, well.
I mean, discussed football.
Well, the idea behind open meetings is you get access to the meeting place. And I got told to wait out there. And y'all are all in here having a discussion, and that shouldn't happen that way. I mean, that's the very thing y'all been getting in trouble for. I wish y'all would behave yourselves.
Sir, if you want to stay in, you are not to address
the
board.
Has the meeting started?
You're not to address the board if you want to stay in the meeting.
I wasn't addressing, I was just making.
If you're saying that the meeting hasn't started, then the meeting hasn't started. So, nothing has been discussed.
All right.
Let me go ahead and turn this on. All right, it's on.
They were in.
All right. We have everybody here. I'm going to call the meeting to order, and this is a normal standard meeting of the Board of Ethics, and we also have a couple of pieces of business that are in the agenda as well, specifically the major one being an advisory opinion that's been requested by Commissioner Amos. So let me go through very quickly and just identify who's here. We have Tim Perry, we have Dr. Rusty Ricketson, we have myself, Bob Charles, we have Lorne Twiner, we have David Van Zandt. We have our counsel, Logan Butler, and we have our clerk, Kathy Echols, also present. And we have some members of the public present in the gallery as well.
Mr. Chairman.
Sir.
Before the meeting is called.
Mm-hmm.
since we're under such scrutiny, my watch and my clock says it's 3 minutes till 10 o'clock because we need to schedule for 10 o'clock. So I would think it would be incumbent for us to wait 3 minutes to begin this meeting.
Probably a very good suggestion.
So that any parties who are seeking to attend said meeting can be here in 3 minutes.
I agree. We will go ahead and just hold off for a few more minutes and make sure it's 10 o'clock. Appreciate the catch and the suggestion.
That's right. There you go.
Let's go ahead and call the meeting order. Let me just run through quickly again, for anybody who wasn't here a minute ago, the attendees. We have Tim Perry, Dr. Rusty Ricketson, myself, Bob Charles, Lorne Twiner, David Van Zandt. We have our board counsel, Logan Butler, and we have our clerk, Kathy Echols, present. We also have several members of the public present, too. So I'm going to call the meeting order. In fact, if we could, let's get a motion and a second to call the meeting order, please.
I move to call the meeting to order.
We have a motion to call the meeting to order. One second. We have a second. All in favor? That is unanimous. All right. And Dr. Ricketson, if you would be kind enough to give us the invocation.
Well, thank you, Father, for this wonderful day. We pray that the proceedings of this meeting will be honoring to you. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. First thing we need to do is adopt the agenda. I believe everybody has a copy of the agenda in front of them. And just to quickly walk through, we'll be adopting the minutes from the November 30th regular meeting and the January 4th called meeting. And also, under old business, have a website update. update on the Board of Ethics versus Sweeney. And then under new business, we have a request for advisory opinion by one of the commissioners, Pete Amos. We also will discuss the upcoming Board of Ethics elections for positions held by Mr. Perry and Mr. Ricketson will be expiring. We have a provision in here to recess for executive session if we need it. I don't know that we will. That is pretty much it for the agenda. So any questions or discussions on the agenda?
I move we adopt the agenda.
All right, we have a motion to adopt the agenda. As it stated, we have a second. All in favor? All right. Adoption of the minutes for the November 30th and January 4th call meetings. I believe we have the copies of those here. Ms. Echols, any comments or anything particular to point out to us on these?
No, sir.
Okay. All right, just give everybody a moment to look through those. Anybody need more time to review the minutes? Okay. Get a motion to adopt the minutes.
So moved.
Get a motion to adopt the minutes from the November 30th and the January 4th meetings. Do I have a second? Second. Motion and a second. All in favor?
Kathy, I was at the panel for this meeting, so
okay. That passes. Four votes and one abstention. All right, so under old business, website update.
Yes, sir. The subpoenas have been removed from the website update as requested at the November 30th meeting. Also, it was changed to update. As you can see in the third paragraph, states that the board meets semi-annually in a public meeting in May and in November of each year. And then you will see, I believe in speaking with Ms. Clark, the previous clerk, we had talked, she had shown me this page about adding frequently asked questions to the website, which would cover some of the questions I do get phone calls on. And it would be advantageous, I believe, to have this on there that I can just direct them to this web page instead of going through and say, well, you got to go to the meeting code, you got to go with this as far as on the ethics ordinance and filing complaints. In the process, I will have to also coordinate with the information technology department on setting this up.
Okay.
That was really the only updates to the website.
Are the frequently asked questions, okay, so these are the list that you've got here are the ones that you'll be putting on?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Butler, have you had a chance to review the FAQ language?
It looks like the language we reviewed probably 2 years ago now at this point.
First, we're talking about creating the website.
Right. Yeah. There have been several amendments since this was last reviewed. So I would suggest that we have an opportunity to kind of look at this in more detail in light of the recent amendments. And I can, if there's anything that I believe needs to be changed, I can just send that to Ms. Echols for y'all to address at your next meeting.
Okay. Yeah, I think that makes sense. I mean, obviously, what we're trying to do here is make it as clear as we can for folks how the process works and what we need to do. So at the same time, we want to make sure there's nothing that conflicts with what's in the ordinance in here. And I think, from my perspective, if you have, especially in light of some of the changes, if there is an additional FAQ or two that you think would be beneficial, feel free to
propose. I can recommend those.
Okay.
And that's all I have.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what, just if we could get a motion to direct Board Counsel, Mr. Butler, to review the FAQs and potentially add to them if needed, and then provide that to us for review and adoption at our next meeting. We have a motion.
A second.
We have a second. All in favor? That is unanimous. Okay, and then just a quick update on the Board of Ed versus Sweeney. Mr. Butler, just want to have you maybe let the folks know where that stands in the process.
Sure.
And what's happening.
Judge Struble, who's a senior judge, was assigned to this case. Both Judge Dickinson and Judge Bagley voluntarily recused themselves from hearing it. This was our action for a declaratory judgment to figure out what to do. A complaint was filed by Mr. Sweeney against each individual member here and an alternate member. You all recused yourselves from that. And there's no procedure in place on what to do, so we sent it to the Superior Court for the court to say what to do. Well, Judge Struble heard some brief argument on that back in April, our very end of March, I believe, and decided he would hear the complaints. As a Superior Court judge, I'll hear the complaints. He set a court date for that to occur, and that was last Friday, a week ago. We appeared in front of Judge Struble. He heard evidence from Mr. Charles, who was there to testify. Mr. Sweeney was present. He testified as well. And then the judge directed myself and Mr. Sweeney to draft basically a brief pointing out applicable law and making our closing arguments in the brief and submit to him. My brief is due Monday. After that, Mr. Sweeney has 10 days to file his brief. At that point, the judge will, I expect, consider both of our briefs, probably look at the transcript, look at all the pleadings, and then we'll issue a ruling. He did make comment in court that day that he had watched all the videos and, you know, seemed to have done a pretty thorough review of the pleadings up to that point. And so that's where we are. Time frame, I have no idea. I don't know how busy his schedule is or what his schedule looks like. I know he wants to get a ruling to us as quickly as possible, but the minimum for him to start looking at it's going to be in about another 12 to 13 days. And then however long it takes him to decide. And he'll do a written order, and that will be sent to everybody. And then we'll give that to Ms. Echols so she can share it with all of you guys.
Okay. Anybody have any questions on that? Okay. Thank you for that. All right, we'll move on to new business. We have in front of us a request for an advisory opinion from one of the sitting commissioners, Commissioner Pete Amos. This is not something that has come up in at least my tenure with the board, but it is a provision within the ordinance that the board may be requested to render an advisory opinion. Before we get into some of the specifics of that, Mr. Butler, maybe you could just kind of give us your perspective on any guidelines for that and
sure.
What you recommend there.
Well, the ordinance is pretty simple. It just says upon written request of any official or employee for an advisory opinion, the ethics board shall issue an advisory opinion. So that's what you have to do. It does not provide a mechanism for doing such. You know, in the complaint realm, it breaks down how the board looks at a complaint, your initial consideration, followed up by a hearing if it's deemed necessary. The ordinance is silent as to a procedure in this regard. I would just say you would conduct it as you would conduct your normal business, and look at the information provided, look at the applicable law, and as a board, reach a decision and answer the questions.
And would we do that likely through a formal response letter to the commissioner, or simply through the notes of our meeting, or what would be the?
I think it would be best if the board were to draft a response letter and have it approved, or have the chairperson sign off on it to send to the commissioner, because then you have a record of what your response is. You're probably, whoever is requesting one of these, you're giving them more guidance if you write a letter saying what your outcome was. I think that would be a good idea.
Okay.
I might be able to help you all out on that.
I'm sorry.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but I don't believe that's legal. I think that you have to, according to my counsel, that you have to render a judgment in public, and you can't go into private session. It says you're supposed to do that in public. So to keep y'all from having any more problems.
We're talking about going into private session.
To clarify, I was not recommending private session. You're going to make your ruling here today, but I do think it needs to also be put in writing.
Ruling needs to be published today, according to the law. I'm sorry to interrupt. I just don't want to see
your name is. Problems.
My name is Joe Moses.
Okay.
I'm trying to help you out with that. It could have gotten a lot messier.
So thank you for that, Mr. Moses.
You're welcome.
And just for reference, if you have something that you want to say, please just ask for the address. We don't normally.
I understand, and I apologize. Just trying to help you all out.
Thank you
for getting busy.
All right, let's. Let's kind of walk through this. We've got. Actually, there are two pieces of input to this. There is an initial letter from the commissioner, which then has some attachments. And then I believe we also have a response that has been provided by, which is on the Jenkins and Bowen letter. Received in the last couple of days.
Mr. Chairman, it was received yesterday.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
The court held a hearing as to the request by appellants to interlocutory relief in July, issued an order denying the relief, the plaintiff's appeal, and be reversed.
What can you understand about that?
I went to Georgia is the problem. I didn't go to Tech. You see where that is?
Right. Yeah, and really, I mean, what happened in this case, there was a commissioner that owned two tracts of property in close proximity to a position property where a landfill was going to be placed.
Yeah.
And the issue was whether or not the commissioner should have voted on that or not, whether or not it would have impacted the value of his adjacent property. Right. And the trial court held that it was not improper, however, it was reversed at the Georgia Supreme Court.
So that's what they did.
Right. It was reversed at the Georgia Supreme Court, and they ended up issuing a ruling saying that it was improper because it directly and immediately impacted the commissioner's pecuniary interest. So, I mean, I think using this case, the prism that we have to analyze these facts through is whether or not a vote by Commissioner Amos would directly and immediately impact his pecuniary interest, or whether the impact would be indirect and remote.
Got it.
And to me, it's pretty clear that, in my opinion, that Mr. Amos doesn't need to, he should abstain from the vote.
I'm sorry, you believe he should abstain from the vote? Yes.
I mean, look, he owns businesses that are buying a substantial amount of water from the county.
Yep.
There's just, in my opinion, that directly impacts his pecuniary interest. And I think it would be improper for him to cast a vote on that issue.
Well, and furthermore, as I read through this, and there's he's provided some good detail on the water volumes and all. I'm not even sure that in of itself, the technical aspect of that is relevant. I think that he has a substantial business interest with both entities. I think that no matter how you slice it, there is at least could be the appearance that he would be at a negotiating disadvantage with one or the other. In what I think we all know are some fairly intense negotiations that have some very significant financial impact to the county, especially in the city of Cumming. So I guess, you know, in reading through this, I would tend to agree. It would certainly be, from a business ethics perspective, it would certainly be a clear-cut recusal, in my opinion.
Bob, can I ask a question?
Please.
Does Amos pay the same amount to the city, or does the water he buys in the county, does he get the same amount dollar volume from the city? And if he buys water, why can't he just buy it from the county and eliminate that?
I don't know the answer 100%. My assumption as I read through this was it has to do with where the properties are located that he services, his water company. So if they are located in such a way that it's best facilitated by buying from the city, that's the ones he does that with. And then, you know, same thing with the county. So I don't think it's necessarily that he I could be wrong, so I didn't get the impression necessarily he picks and chooses. It has to do with location of the properties that he serves. Anybody else know anything about that?
No, it definitely has to do with the service area.
Okay, that's what I was
where the city service lines are, where the county.
Yeah.
I mean, unless you have a well, that's the only water utility you have.
Mm-hmm. So, I'm sorry, I interrupted what you were saying.
But, you know, I guess he has to be making profit on this. Is that what we're really after? In other words, if he makes a profit, it's an ethics violation?
Well, I think making profit is not an ethics violation, in my opinion. But the issue here is, does he have a direct business engagement with the entities that he's, you know, are in the middle of a very intense negotiation for water rates on? So it's not as much whether he makes a profit or not, it's he has a business interest in both of these water situations here, the city and the county. You know, you can have all sorts of directions that somebody might presume that goes. Is he a negotiating disadvantage if he does something that one of the entities doesn't like, especially the city, since he's a county commissioner? You know, does that does that put him in a position where he could be penalized in his water purchases later? I mean, those are all the types of things that I think weigh in a situation like this. Is he in a position to freely and aggressively negotiate on behalf of the entity he represents, in this case, the county? And my opinion, with the business interests he has here, I think it would certainly be more suitable for a recusal.
And if I may interject, to clarify that question or give you some guidance, if you look at the county ordinance, which under Muni Code is 2-64, subpart B, number 10, it reads, never take any official action with regard to any matter under circumstances in which he knows or should know that he has a direct or indirect monetary interest in the subject matter of such matter or in the outcome of such official action. That paragraph is also closely in line with what Mr. Van Zandt read from the case law that was provided. They're very similar in terms. And while discussing it's great, I just want to point out you've got the law that Mr. Van Zandt read aloud, plus you've got this particular prong of the ordinance itself to consider in looking at this.
I mean, I think the very narrow issue is whether the price of water will impact his bottom line, and it will.
Sure.
I have nothing further to add because I agree with the statements that have been previously made. I think it's evident he has a conflict here and needs to recuse himself of participating in that particular vote.
Tim? I think the municipal code is going to provide the framework for our opinion. That takes, quite honestly, that takes opinion out of it if there's clarity in the municipal code.
He has direct involvement, there's no question about that.
Yeah.
So that would be a violation.
All right. Other discussion on this? At this point, based on the discussion so far, I think we're at a point where we can ask for a motion, and then we'll need to decide exactly how we want to structure the response. In fact, let me ask Mr. Butler. I'm trying to be respectful of the folks' time here on the board. Is there any way that we can draft a letter and without having to reconvene for 2 minutes to approve the letter in person? Is there any way to do it by mail or by email or by conference call, as long as the record is public on the vote?
Well, no, you can't do that.
Okay.
I think how you have to do it is you have to make your ruling here.
Oh, no, we'll make the ruling. I'm talking about the drafting of a letter.
Then you can direct me to draft a letter in response to Mr. Amos that just says, this is what they said, refer to the minutes.
Right.
I do think you need something in writing to support his records.
Yeah.
But the actual ruling is what you guys decide today.
I
can just draft.
Do we need to then somehow vote to affirm the letter once you've written the language?
I don't think you have to. Okay. If you just want me to send him an update and refer him to the minutes,
yeah,
I think we can do that without reconvening. Just make that decision today.
Okay. All right. So based on the discussion, I would look for a motion that, based on the evidence that we have and based on the case law that's been discussed and, let's say, the ordinance as well, that we direct an advisory opinion to in response to Commissioner Amos suggesting that he recuse himself from votes on this particular matter, given his business interest in the water. We have a motion for that.
So moved.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and we have a second. All in favor? That is unanimous.
And then we further need a motion to direct our counsel, Mr. Butler, to draft a letter citing the appropriate sections of the law that we've discussed here, as well as referring to the minutes of our discussion and suggesting to the commissioner that he recuse himself.
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second. Second. Motion and a second. All in favor? And that is unanimous. Counsel, any other official motions we need to make regarding this?
Well, you do, I think, need to consider two other prongs that Commissioner Amos raised in his letter.
Okay.
The bulk of his letter deals with A&A water and all the matters that you just discussed and made a ruling on. If you go to the last page of his letter, first full paragraph at the top, he raises a second issue regarding the fact that he purchases yes. water from the City of Cumming as a regular customer. He doesn't resell it for, I guess, businesses, home accounts, or whatever. He has it spelled out there. And wants to know if that would be a conflict of interest. And then thirdly, the paragraph below that, he raises the third issue of a 1992 lawsuit between Amos Plumbing and Electric and Forsyth County, stating he has an interest in Amos Plumbing and Electric, and that wants to know if that is in any way a potential conflict. So I do think the board needs, since he specifically requested those two issues, the board needs to discuss those two issues and also make a ruling on them as well.
Would they not be rendered moot now because of our ruling with respect to the?
I mean, potentially, part? Yes. I guess the way I'm looking at it is it says when someone requests in writing an advisory opinion, one shall be given. He's making this request in writing. So I'm suggesting that y'all probably need to consider it.
Yeah, I agree. He does sort of break it out into
he breaks it out
two additional items. Yeah.
Separate items. And I think that's probably the best way to proceed.
The second paragraph, as I understand it, he basically is just stating his business as a customer in the City of Cumming.
Sure.
That, I mean, it's just a public utility that services his area. So I don't see that he has a choice there.
No.
Every commission would have to.
Yeah, exactly. Pretty much shut everything down at that point.
And if I can just point out to the board in your consideration of this issue, under section 2-62 definitions, if you look at the definition of interest, it states interest means a direct or indirect pecuniary or material benefit accruing to the county official or employee as a result of a contract or transaction. It goes on to state that there's an exception for such contracts or transactions, which by their terms and by the substance of their provisions confer the opportunity and right to realize the accrual of similar benefits to all other persons and or properties similarly situated. Which I think is a fancy way to say what Mr. Perry was just saying. He's just a typical water customer, and any decision made there would affect everyone else who's a typical water consumer for the city or the county. That's how I read that definition, but I will point the board to that to interpret it and look at that in responding.
I would certainly agree with that. I think where your personal business water is supplied is, of course, of where you're located would have any raise any flags, in my opinion. Any other comments on that? Thoughts from anybody?
Do we need to vote on that?
Well, I think we should take these one at a time and just, at that, I just want to make sure that anybody else, anybody disagree with that assessment? Okay. All right, so we're looking for a motion to add to the opinion, specifically addressing the section on business and personal water being purchased, that we do not, in fact, see that individually as a conflict of interest or concern. I would direct Mr. Butler to add that as a secondary response
in the letter to Commissioner Amos.
I'll make that motion.
We have a motion. We have a second. And a second. All in favor? All right. Carries unanimously. All right. And the final one. The lawsuit remains Point Electric and Forsyth County. I guess I'm not quite clear on this one. Is he says he's been questioned as whether a conflict of interest exists because of that lawsuit. Is he referring to a conflict of interest on this the same water discussion that the previous sections have been about, or a just a more generalized conflict of interest of some sort? Anybody have any thoughts on that?
The 92 cases, I mean, it's a closed case. He attached a final order.
Right.
So that was kind of a done deal, so to speak. I would probably assume that, looking at the tone of this whole letter, he's asking in regards to his ability to participate in the negotiations, which in a way you've already addressed through his first request.
Yep.
But do think you need to address this one as well in some form.
Okay.
Briefly, Amos Plumbing was providing water to several subdivisions in the county as a private provider. Their right to do that was given to them through the deed to some property. They had water lines installed and they were delivering water to these several subdivisions. The county then took all these roads in as county roads and began installing water utilities themselves on these roads. And many of the customers of Amos Plumbing had the option to link on to the county system. The basis of this lawsuit was whether the county's actions there were a taking under eminent domain, where a government can take someone's property for just compensation to use it for public good. That was the gist of this complaint, is whether this was a taking that Amos Plumbing had to be compensated for. The way the court analyzed it, it says in the order it was a matter of first impression at the time, that the pipe works and the things the county installed did not in any way encroach or interfere with the existing pipe lines. They just simply ran parallel and found that there was not a physical taking of property in that regard. There's also, it cited to some law where certain contractual rights can be property rights that could be taken under the eminent domain clause. And in analyzing that, the court found that did not apply to Amos Plumbing, that there was no taking here, and dismissed their suit to receive compensation for this water service company. So that's the gist of it. If that makes sense to everybody.
My question is, where does the conflict of interest come in?
I guess because this had to do with water systems, the only reason I can think of people to be making a connection here.
Yeah, I don't see how this lawsuit 20 years ago in and of itself would create a conflict such that he would have to recuse himself, in my opinion.
Is there an implication here that he would have some sort of animus toward the parties involved and would not act appropriately? Is that
possible? I haven't thought about that.
I might be able to help you on that too if you want me to address it.
I don't want to make too much of a habit of that. Gentlemen, would you like to take a moment to hear from Mr. Moses?
Sure. It's just real simple. I'm actually the one that brought that up to begin with. That's where it came from. And it just goes to the state of mind that Pete Amos. That he himself, if you read that, he himself is admitting that he has a conflict with the county in there. So that's how it ties in to, because he sued the county because he was having a conflict with them. And so that's how that lawsuit ties in. It goes into the frame of mind that obviously he realized he had a conflict because he sued him.
So, I mean, it's pretty simple.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
You know, I really don't think it'd be any different than any eminent domain condemnation proceeding on any level. If the commissioner owned a piece of property that ended up being condemned for some reason or, you know, taken, I don't think that would necessarily mandate a recusal in any negotiations with the dealing with the county contract. I think this, you know, we've already addressed the issue of whether or not we believe it'd be appropriate for him to vote on the contract. I don't think if the entire basis for the recusal was on this lawsuit 20 years ago, I do not think a conflict would exist. In my opinion.
Yeah, with certainly all due respect, I think we've already made a decision on the first issue. I mean, there's no sense in piling on. This was something 20 years ago. If somebody tried to take some of my property directly or indirectly, I'd probably want to sue the county too.
Absolutely.
I mean, he was exercising his constitutional
Absolutely.
Right. But that has since been settled.
Well, yeah, I think the real issue here is does it have any applicability with what's going on currently today? And I'm having trouble finding it. Was decided for the county, I guess, at the end, right?
It was. Plaintiff's case was dismissed.
Yep. If I'm reading this correctly, it appears these last two items we've discussed, and currently discussing, actually were supported documents or issues related to the first. Is that correct? But these are just substantively, well, he had a conflict about 20 years ago, so that shows that he had a conflict, that, you know, that a conflict does exist. And so but we already settled that. And the fact that he needs to accuse himself because of an obvious conflict, this pecuniary interest involved. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah,
so
I think
so this is Jack actually rendered moot. I think so too.
We just have an obligation
to address it.
And
I think by saying, writing, we could write to him that based upon our prior decision that the third question is rendered moot in that sense, or could, whatever the legal phrasing needs to be done.
Right. I think that what we, because ethics ordinance says we shall provide an advisory opinion. And
okay.
If these are interpreted as three different inquiries, then we'd have to render three different opinions. And
so what's our third opinion is basically the question.
Yeah, it's a little gray, but he does appear to be asking three different, albeit maybe related to the current discussion of the water. But it almost does appear he's asking three different things here. So I'm just,
I would interpret it as asking for one advisory opinion with a bunch of supporting detail.
Yeah.
And all of these things considered, one, two, three, you know, should he recuse himself? And I think we've already answered that question. Yes, he should.
Yeah, I mean, to Commissioner Amos's credit, because questions have been raised, he just sent us a letter, asked for an opinion, and has given us full disclosure.
Absolutely.
And asked for our opinion, so certainly I would commend him for that.
Put all the cards on the table and let me know what you think.
And let's, one way or another, let's move forward.
That's all right.
Well, nice to have it up front instead of at the end, that's for sure.
Logan, do you think we can, should we still address this as three separate opinions, or can we address it as one advisory opinion and give him one response?
I think you can do it as one advisory opinion. Mm-hmm. However,
either way, it's going to have the same result.
It's right. Going to have the same result, but I do think since he delineated three particular potential conflicts of interest, you should make a ruling on that to some extent, address all three.
Okay.
Because he did, I think, raise three particular issues.
We've addressed the first one. and the second one. So the remaining issue is whether or not the lawsuit regarding the taking of his property would create a conflict of interest under the statute.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, to kind of give a specific opinion on that, we almost would have to take it in and of itself. You know, in other words, if the other two items were not on, that was what was in question from us. Is that enough to, you know, to have us recommend that he would recuse himself, for example, under the current negotiations?
Which would have been the same exercise we just went through for the second scenario.
Exactly.
The fact that he purchased water from the county.
That's right.
If this was the only issue before us, the taking of his property, then I think that would not create a conflict such that he would have to recuse himself.
I think that I would concur with that. I don't see anything in this 1992 case that leads me to believe it would have an effect on his ability to negotiate in good faith on a water contract in the year 2012.
No, but the last two items, based on their own merit, I don't see it directly related to it, so that's just my opinion.
I agree. Lorne, any thoughts?
I feel the same way.
Rusty?
We have one more on that.
Okay. All right. In light of that, let's go ahead and treat this the same way we have the other two. I need a motion that it is the opinion of the Board of Ethics that the third item specific to the 1992 action between Commissioner Amos' company and the county does not, in our opinion, create a conflict of interest or an ethical issue related to the current water negotiations.
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a second.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor? And that is unanimous. And then we need a motion on also appending that portion of the opinion to the response letter that counsel has brought up. We have a motion. We have a second.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion second. All in favor? Unanimous as well. Okay. Mr. Butler, anything else that we need to address or votes that we need to take relative to that particular agenda item?
I don't believe so.
Okay. If I can find my agenda, we'll move on. There it is. Closes out our advisory opinion, and I guess we should just before we leave that entirely, let's clarify a little bit of the detail around that. You're going to go ahead and draft a letter, and that will be then mailed to the commissioner.
I would anticipate the letter stating this is being written as a courtesy to give him some insight as to what the board decided today, the minutes of the board, how the actual ruling, but that the board found that. Because of his involvement with ANA Water, it is a direct financial interest conflict, and the board recommends him abstaining or recusing himself from these negotiations for that. In regards to the second two, the board discussed in and of themselves, you don't find it to be a conflict, but due to your decision under the first prong, you've decided that the conflict exists as to that. That's what I anticipate the letter saying on behalf of the board.
Should we provide a recommendation or just tell them how we would rule?
Well, I mean, I think if you find that it's a conflict, the rules say you're to abstain and recommend that he follow that rule.
Okay.
I don't think there's a problem with you advising that.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's our advisory opinion. I think we have to be clear on what it is. I don't know if that forces him to do that, but nonetheless. We want to be clear with our opinions.
Right, I think it's fine.
Okay, thank you. All right. Next item under new business is the upcoming Board of Ethics elections for positions held by Mr. Tim Perry. who is the appointee of the elected officials in the county, and Dr. Rusty Ricketson, who is the full-time employees appointee. Ms. Echols, do you want to address that?
Yes, sir. Both of their terms end July the 1st, and neither one has decided to seek to hold this to be appointed again. So the elected officials have provided nominations with which I've spoken with their nominee, and he is thinking about it. And then today is the deadline for the employees to submit their nominees. When they submit the two I've got, will be contacted to provide biographical information, and then it will go out to the employees, and I anticipate a vote in about 2 weeks. And it's in order to get on to the June work session so that they can be confirmed by the Board of Commissioners by the time that, of July 1st.
Okay, so the positions expire as of July 1st?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to address that, if I may. As you know, I'm the appointee of the county elected officials, not including the Board of Commissioners. That includes the following offices: the district attorney, the probate judge, the clerk of court, sheriff, tax commissioner, the coroner, the chief magistrate, solicitor general, both superior court judges, and both state court judges. And I've served 5 2-year terms. And at the end of this, my 10th year, it'll conclude my service to Board of Ethics. And I just want to say to the board, and certainly to the elected officials that elected me to represent them on this board for the last 10 years, I always consider community service an honor, and it's I just appreciate the opportunity. I've tried to serve on this board with integrity and honesty, and I just appreciate the opportunity to serve with all of you, and I appreciate the opportunity to represent the elected officials.
Well, thank you very much, and certainly you and Dr. Ricketson both have been on the board from the time I got here several years back, and I believe since the board's inception. So we certainly thank you for your dedicated service, probably longer than most folks would serve on a volunteer board. So,
well, Mr. Chairman, let me just piggyback on what Tim said and say it has been an honor to serve the people in Forsyth County, especially the full-time employees of Forsyth County, serving on this board at its inception, and watching how it has matured and grown. And so I just want to thank you all for your participation and being a part of this.
Very good. Well, thank you again for your service. Really, really appreciate it. I know it can be a thankless job sometimes, but I appreciate both of you serving as long as you have. In fact, I would like to make a motion that we recognize and formally thank both Mr. Perry and Dr. Ricketson for their long and dedicated service to the board. We have a motion. We have a second. Motion and second. All in favor of formally recognizing? Yes, Mr. Twiner. That moves. Passes by 3 votes.
You didn't want to recognize yourself.
Three to two.
Exactly. Well, thank you again. It's very, very much appreciated. With that, the only things left were some placeholders if we needed to go to executive session. I don't believe we do, unless anybody else has a different opinion on that.
Okay. I believe so.
All right. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
We have a motion.
Second.
And we have a second. All in favor? All right. Thanks, everybody.
Amen.
Thanks. I would like to say you guys did the county proud today. On your meeting, I know that it's a thankless job, and I know that you've had some problems, today. You all did a very nice job of representing the county, and I, as a citizen, certainly do appreciate that. And you've had some bad bad press, but you know, I think he deserves some good press. And I think thanks to you, you know.
Well, thank you for the kind words.
Thank you.
One of these you said you. I need you to sign these. Yes. Okay.
I got one coming. That new ordinance allows me to call a meeting.
Oh, no.
Your first year will be 1 year.
Yeah, exactly. Which is how I might be texting sometime.
I got rear-ended 2 weeks ago. I was in my truck.
No way.
No injuries. His wife showed up to pick him up, and she was like 8 months pregnant. I was just so thankful she wasn't in her car with him. That was sort of freaked me out. I got rear-ended 2 weeks ago.
Did you get hurt or anything?
No.
Thank you.
No comment on that.
And I'll rescind my recommendation that you be the chair. I rescind my resentment.
Tim, we'll see you next time.
All right.
Thanks very much, Mark, sir.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you.
Good to see you. Good to see you.
Hate to see you go. Kathy, thank you for everything.
Thank you.
I want to
continue to serve on the boat. We'll see you soon. Actually, I guess Logan will send out that letter to the copy.
Yes, I appreciate it. Okay.
Terrific.
Wow. Thank you.
That's nice.
Yeah, that's my voice badge.
So you're busy. Yeah. It's hard to get everything.
Coach my daughter's softball team.
You coach it?
Yeah, I have 13-year-old girls around.
Good luck to you. Hi, Logan.
Good to see you. You're welcome. Talk to you later. Give me a hug out of you. Thank you. I know. It's so good. It's a one-handed hug.
Yeah. We'll catch up.
Hey, man.
Been nice knowing you guys.
All right.
We'll
see you around for sure.
Yeah, I know it.
Even with that Georgia Tech.
That Georgia Tech brings class.
It does. It really does.
What kind of class?
First class.
I love it.
We appreciate y'all. See y'all later. I appreciate y'all.